Mange har sagt, at orkestret er hans egentlige instrument. Men han sætter sig gerne hen ved klaveret i pausen mellem to pladeoptagelser. Vi er i National Studios på 49. gade i New York City. Det er den 4. april, og Ellington benytter 4 overliggerdage til at indspille nye plader. Han har benyttet hver fristund i de over 40 år, han har haft orkester, til at skrive nyt, til at øve, til at indspille, til at forberede. Han fylder 70 år den 29. april, men han er lige ungdommelig, lige charmerende og elegant, som dengang han fik tilnavnet The Duke, Hertugen. Det var i 1906. Han har båret tilnavnet med rette. Han er orkestermusikkens fyrstelige højhed, og hans utallige kompositioner, der spænder fra små sange til kirkekoncerter, bærer alle geniets blå adelsstempel. Han har modtaget priser, er udnævnt til æresborger her og der, og han er hyldet som en af det 20. århundredes største musikalske personligheder. Det er i år mere end et halvt århundrede siden, at Edward Kennedy Duke Ellington besluttede at blive musiker. Det var i Washington, hvor faren var butler i Det Hvide Hus.
My musical background? Well, I'll tell you, it was in the ear, you know, loving it. You know, I think that the, there's such a close relationship with the performer and the listener. They have a kinship, like I say. They both serve the same muse, you know.
But once you decided to be a musician and not a painter.
Well, I was a good painter. I had good talent. And I won a scholarship in fine art. But by the time I finished high school, which was when I was 18, because I was too deeply involved in music, I was then at the point where I was trying to, well, I had a local reputation. I was trying to get to learn some more music so I could protect my reputation. Very important, your local reputation.
I 1918 dannede Duke sammen med nogle kammerater The Washingtonians. Omkring samme tid fik han sit første job som professionel musiker.
I played the worst piano in the world from 8 to 1 for 75 cents alone. Had no rhythm section. And the woman was desperate for a piano player. And I was the only thing left in town, so she had to take me. And she got, then she paid the 75 cents and I ran home like a thief. And I only knew about 3 or 4 numbers and I kept changing tempos, playing slow, fast, medium tempo.
Fats Waller var en af Dukes favoritter. Og det var Fats, der fik lokket orkestret til New York endnu en gang efter fiaskoturen i 1923. I New York blev Duke nær ven med en anden favorit, stregklaverspillets ukronede konge, James P. Johnson. Og i New York mødte Duke den pianist, der skulle få størst betydning for hans klaverspil, Willie The Lion Smith. The Lion spillede på Capitol Theatre, og han husker første aften, Duke kom ind.
So I saw this good-looking guy walk up to me and says, hello there, Lion. Says, I'd like to sit in with the boys. I said, this will do you good, young fella. I said, you better sit in. I said, I think you get a lot of riffs in, a lot of ideas. He sat down and played So Duke, sit down. I'll get back to my story. I won't let you off. I'll stay on that one subject. So anyhow, they had a publishing place in New York then by the name of Irvin Mills, who you know recently was associated with Duke, you boys. The Mills, Irvin and his brother and all the sons and daughters, make the long story short, they wanted a band leader, and they had the Blue Rhythm Band, all type of bands. Lucky Melinda, you name them, and they had them. I took one look at the guy and I was talking to the man one day. I said, look, I said, there's a young chap in here, a handsome guy, tall. I said, and above all, he can improvise and memorize. So they put Duke in front of the band. I don't have to tell you what happened ever since, the six pieces. He rebuilt the six pieces up to, I think it was 9 or 10 pieces, 11 pieces, at the Club Kentucky, which was downtown. I know you boys have heard it, heard about it if you read.
Den 4. december 1927 indledte The Washingtonians, der var blevet udvidet fra 5 til 10 mand, et femårs engagement på den berømte Cotton Club. Det var arrangeret af musikforlæggeren Irving Mills, som nu også satte gang i pladeindspilninger, radioudsendelser og film.
How did it happen that the Cotton Club was a turning point for you?
Well, that was, it happened at the time, was two things were happening at that time. First of all, it was at the real launching, not the launching, but when it was really catching, when radio was first catching on. And we had a transcontinental wire out of the Cotton Club. We were broadcasting almost every night across the country. And at the same time, all the other big bands in the world were imitating Paul Whiteman and playing big grandiose fanfares and all that sort of thing. And we had a very plaintive style, and it sort of broke through. As a matter of fact, and at the same time, Lombardo was coming along with his style. And they, you know, both were contrasted by all these other people imitating Whiteman.
Ellingtons jungle style var allerede skabt i Kentucky Club, hvor han udnyttede trompetisten Bubba Miles og bassonisten Charlie Irvis growlspil i sin musik. Og mood-stilen, den mere eksotiske, blev udviklet i Cotton Club. Folk, der kom med, da orkestret flyttede til Cotton Club i 1927, var alle musikalske personligheder. Baritonsaxofonisten Harry Carney har været medlem lige siden. Saxofongruppen blev i 1928 styrket med blandt andre New Orleans-klarinettisten Barney Bigard, hvis klang og spillestil Ellington udnyttede i stor stil i de kommende årtier. Trompetisten Bubba Miley blev i 1929 afløst af Cootie Williams. Også Williams er i dag et fremtrædende medlem af Ellington-orkestrets klangpanel. Altsaxofonisten Johnny Hodges var også kommet til i 28. Hodges er stadig en af orkestrets fornemste solister, og en af de musikere, Ellington har lagt stærkt vægt på i sine kompositioner. Duke har altid arbejdet med det menneskemateriale, han har haft for hånden.
Well, we write to the individual and provide him with a fitting ornamentation, and he has complete freedom, and we, but other than that, the individual is supposed to establish a state of compatibility for teamwork, you know.
And our quiet salute on the occasion of the 400th anniversary of the Bard, a little bit from the Romeo and Juliet. It's called The Star-Crossed Lovers. The soloist is Johnny Hodges. Johnny Hodges.
Teddy Wilson giver en vurdering af Ellington som pianist.
Well, to define it, let's see. Remember, earlier we mentioned that Duke Ellington could be regarded as of the stride style of school, where the left hand continuously plays like a rhythm section, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, like that, which originally, I suppose, was for people to dance to when they didn't have drums or bass. The left hand plays like a dance rhythm, and the right hand plays against it with melodic patterns and various little figures, trills and runs and whatnot, which characterize that style. And that's the basic thing there. But Ellington, with his excursions into new sounds and harmonies, he adds this to, and he might very often, without playing the stride, he'll play a run that's like a splash of color, like you might take some colored sand and throw it up in the air and it drifts down. He'll make that kind of sounds on the keyboard. And always experimenting with individual sounds that are strictly Ellington and no one else. I suppose you classical fans might hear a little reminiscent of Ravel tonalities in Ellington harmonies. But his, the basic technique, I think, would be mainly a stride player, but then these other things that are so interesting into harmony are also a very important part of the Ellington trademark on the keyboard.
The Lion om Ellington som komponist og orkesterleder.
The greatest way to find out how good a man is to test him. Now, Duke is the only guy who can direct a band, and no guys in a band don't give him no cues. He gives them the cues. That's what you call a director, a man who thinks good. He writes 13th chords, which would be... That's modern chord. This, the guys were writing when we was kids. That's how far they was. And this generation will never catch up. They might qualify near it. Of your Debussy's, Ravel, Chopin, Victor Herbert, Ellington, Madame Chaminade. And the crazy guy, who's the crazy composer we got? The wild man, Stravinsky. See all the stuff like this? Now the guys call it stride. It means two-handed piano playing. They write it like that. Now I'll take the same strain from Stravinsky from an opera.
Sønnen Mercer om hvordan orkesterprøverne foregår.
He doesn't run it. He lets it run itself. And for instance, if he writes a number, he may say, well, I like it a little louder here, or I want a quasi effect there, or so forth. But for the most part, our music has no markings on it. And if he puts it out for a rehearsal, we just play, and whatever comes out is a normal way for the guys to blow it. Then he accepts that. For the most part, I think he's envisioned it anyhow. He knows that when he puts Johnny on the lead, or if he has Cat screaming certain things, it's going to come out, and that's his way of playing. Because when he writes, he doesn't write the instrument, he writes the man. And he's pretty cagey that way.
Ellington tilbringer 1/10 af sin tid på koncertturné. Hvad foretrækker han at spille for et publikum eller i et grammofonstudio?
Oh, it doesn't make any difference as long as you have fun with music, it's all right. But you know, if it ain't fun, it ain't worth it.
No.
You know, and that's it.
But is there any difference between the jazz audience of today and in the 30s?
Well, I don't know. We don't encounter an audience as a jazz audience, I don't think. I don't know. I mean, we have a rather wide range of the tonal character, and we don't get a chance to discriminate, to decide who is what. We go into areas, for instance, where people don't know anything about the word jazz, anything about anything. Like we've been into the Far East, and you're playing in a ballpark or something for 6,000 people. Well, in a country in the Far East where you have billions of people, a very, very tiny percentage of them have even heard of the word jazz, you know, or know anything about it. And so we can't depend upon it, the word. We can't depend upon anything. You just have to go out and you do a performance. And the performance is believable, they respond. If it's acrobatic, they respond. If it's sensuous, they respond. And that's all we can depend upon. The name doesn't mean anything. It's all in how believable or how sensitive the oral presentation And if it's agreeable to their ear, then you are very fortunate, because then you are together, you know. Like when, I would say, like, when your pulse and my pulse are together, we're swinging, which is total agreement, you know.
We'd like to do a thing now called Dances in Love. Dances in Love is a little thing that's played by a piano player, and along about in the middle of it, there are breaks in the melody. And usually the gentlemen of the orchestra fill these breaks by snapping their fingers, one, two, three. And they want you to join them and snap your fingers too, one, two, three. I'll tell you when.
I 1928 begyndte Ellington at anvende den menneskelige stemme i sin musik, blandet ordløs sang i orkesterklangen. Og i 1932 fik orkestret sin første virkelige sangerinde, Ivy Anderson. Ellingtons seneste anvendelse af den menneskelige stemme har fundet sted i de religiøse koncerter.
Have you any plans on going further with the human voice in your music?
No, we use the voice in you know, when we do our sacred concerts, you know. But nothing that too complicated, because every time we do a sacred concert, we use a different choir. And it's just a little too much to overcome. You know, you have to go to a cathedral or church, and it's a big job, I mean, to learn the stuff just as it is, you know. And to go into something where you combine it with instruments, it has to be a very highly personalized artist. You could do it with, you know, if you had Alice Babs to play with every day, you know, it'd be great. And, you know, she, incidentally, was with us when we premiered our new sacred concert here at the St. John Divine, the Cathedral of St. John Divine.
Would you call your sacred music for jazz?
Jazz? We don't use the word jazz. As a matter of fact, we haven't used it since 1943. We believe that everything is so highly personalized that you just can't find a category big enough. And jazz certainly isn't big enough a category to combine so many wonderful people in it. You know, you go back and you take all the great people who have been listed in the history of jazz, like Bechet and Armstrong and, you know, all of them, you know, Django, Dizzy Gillespie, Hawk, all great people, Ben Webster, everybody's got his own individual style, you know? And the Diz has got his ding, you know, and Hawk's got his hing, and Bird had his bing, you know, and who else? Rabbit has his ring, and who else is his name?
Yeah. Carnegie Hall den 23. januar 1943. Ellington opfører blandt andet sin Black, Brown and Beige suite, kulminationen på svingtiden. Orkestret havde undergået en række forandringer i de forløbende år. Tenorsaxofonisten Ben Webster var kommet til, og bassoongruppen havde i en årrække været den stærkeste i orkestrets historie. Tricky Sam Nanton, Juan Tisol og Lawrence Brown. Orkestrets høje standard i begyndelsen af 40'erne skyldtes også den unge bassist Jimmy Blanton, der døde allerede i 42.
Don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing. It don't mean a thing, all you gotta do is swing. Makes no difference if it's sweet or hot. Just give that rhythm every little thing you've got. It don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing.
En anden fornyelse var den unge pianist Billy Strayhorn, som Ellington gjorde til sin højre hånd i arbejdet med orkestret. Strayhorn var meget produktiv og skrev blandt andet orkestrets nye kendingsmelodi Take the A-Train. Strayhorn, der døde i maj 1967, var en nær personlig ven af Ellington.
I heard Strayhorn, somebody brought him to the theater. We were playing Pittsburgh and brought him after the first show and said, this young man has got a lot of talent and I think you should hear him. And he sat down and played some of his music and the lyrics, and they had such perfect wedding of words and music. And I said, gee, I'm going to bring you to New York and let you write lyrics for me. So finally, he came to New York. And when he came, I was just about to leave for Scandinavia. And it was 1939. So I left him at my house with my son and my sister. And while I was gone for 6 weeks, he was there, going through my scores. And he had wonderful musical training, schooling, and but he had never written for a band. And so he got these ideas and started to playing with them. And one day we had a small band date, you know, six pieces, eight or something. And I got stuck for a number. I said, well, write this, do something. And he did it, and everybody's eyes popped when they heard what he played, because, you know, it was wonderful, the first thing. And then, of course, came the, in 1940, came the renaissance of vocal background orchestration when he did Flamingo. And then, of course, it's been flowering ever since. Now, everybody's getting extravagant with backgrounds, you know? But Strayhorn, I think, was really the renaissance of it.
Foruden Strayhorn har kun Mercer skrevet jævnligt til orkestret.
Yes, some very little. I've done quite a bit of writing, but the amount of it that I get played is rare because, I think the, some sort of a fetish drive hit Duke Ellington shortly after Billy Strayhorn's death. And something about it, it's as if Strayhorn is still there writing with him, or as if he feels he has to do the work for the two of them now that Billy's gone. And he's been quite prolific in his production and output. I think he's almost doubled the amount of work that he's been doing.
Did your father teach you writing?
Yes. He taught me in a way I think I had to go to school and get a great deal of education after his having taught me to appreciate the way he taught me, because his was just a matter of knowing sound and saying what sounds good and is good, never a don't. In fact, this is his basic philosophy. I don't remember him telling me not to do anything in life, period, much less music. But he wound up saying, or I say, should say that Getches wound up saying the same thing that Duke Ellington said some 20 years later, that I've taught you these rules to suggest what sounds good and to give you some sort of a measurement. But if it sounds good, overlook what I've told you.
I think you have to be pretty close to Duke Ellington to catch the special Ellington sound.
Well, I think it's more than just the sound. You have to be close to him to catch his way of living and the way he thinks and the feel of it. Gradually, if you're with him long enough, you do become engulfed by it. And if you're going to communicate what you feel, then you begin to write the sound of Ellington. You can't help it.
When you write a new song, do you always work at the piano, or?
No. If an idea comes, it can come at the piano, it can come away from the piano, it can come while you're riding around the country. So it comes when you have isolation, mental isolation. And it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to be alone. It can happen when you're with other people, you can be in a big crowd, but you have that mental isolation, something stimulates and comes out.
When is the greatest moment when you have written a new song?
Oh, tonight, I hope. You know, that's it. That's a great night. The new baby, that's the one.
Thank you.
Er det trættende for musikerne altid at spille de samme numre?
Well, it possibly would be if it wasn't for audience reaction. That makes it that keeps it from becoming monotonous, and that we get a chance to watch the expressions on the people's faces, and it becomes very inspiring, you know, when you get a good audience reaction. You forget we've been playing the same thing for so many years.
The audience today and the audience 40 years ago, what's the difference?
Well, I should say, it's not that I'm age conscious, but 40 years ago, there was a different feeling as far as I'm concerned, because I was younger and had more fire, vim, vop, vitality. Of course, being so young, always interested in the female audience reaction, shall we say. And how the people responded to us was always a good thing, plus the fact we were always getting invited out to the various clubs. There were a lot of nightclubs at that time. And after our performance, we would be invited to clubs and homes of people. But now, of course, we move too fast, and there are not so many nightclubs. So after work, there's very little to do other than get in the car and proceed on to the next city or next place of engagement.
Ever since you started, you have been traveling a great deal. How have you been able to keep a band together for 40 years?
Oh, I have a very simple gimmick. I give them the money, I get the kicks.
Ellingtons sekretær i 40'erne, Ines Cavanaugh.
So I say that Duke Ellington has been the most mismanaged, ill-managed, mismanaged, which is correct. It hasn't been because of publicity. It hasn't been because of any of the usual tricks of the trade. It's been because this man has had a determination to keep his band together in good times, in bad times. He's never shirked it, and he's never let it go. It has cost him an awful lot to keep it together during some of the years, but he didn't mind. He went cheerfully on. I've never heard him complain about it. I've never heard him complain about Paul Whiteman being the king of jazz or anybody else, you know. I mean, he had a job to do. He was busy doing it. He wasn't worrying about titles.
I understand you take care of the money business for the band. But what about the discipline in the band?
Well, the only way we really call for discipline is when the airplane leaves at 7 o'clock, we like for everyone to be there at 7 o'clock. The condition that they're in has nothing to do with that. Our schedules are so rough and so heavy at times. A man has to be human and do certain things that give him some sort of pleasure, I guess. And I guess in Europe you might refer to it as schnapps or something. But I think we all really enjoy the life. We gripe, you know, like soldiers or whatever. But there's no demand for discipline. There's a pride within the orchestra that keeps a certain discipline, self-discipline, in fact, of the men going themselves.
That's right. Mr. Ellington, about the future, what are you working on now?
The future? Oh, nothing much. I'm doing an opera, an ice ballet. And three shows, and little knickknacks for the cats in the band to play. So, you know, and a little planning for my next sacred concert, which is, I'm just about decided what's going to be in it anyway. So when I get a deadline, then I will start to putting it on paper.
Prøverne går videre. Duke er i kontrolrummet for at høre orkesterbalancen. Sangerinden har gemt sig bag lydisolerende plader. Det er den sidste optagelse i denne omgang. I morgen tidlig går det afsted igen. 6 ugers koncertturné, et nyt sted hver aften. Kun en dag står åben på Dukes rejseplan, den 29. april. Der er man i hans fødeby, Washington. Præsidenten giver gallamiddag i Det Hvide Hus til ære for hertugen.